For an adult audience, LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam, that's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. And tonight, a dear friend slash guest, Dicky Barrett of the Mighty Mighty Bosstones, and new announcer of Jimmy Kimmel Live. Oh, yes. That's,
We all do that.
Yeah, but I'm telling the world.
Thanks, Anderson.
You're telling our listeners, I see.
Yeah, so Dicky is out here, obviously.
Where do you live now?
Well, I'm not going to tell you. I know.
Roosevelt Hotel.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, buddy.
I just imagine.
Thanks, dude. No, actually, the Millennium Hotel.
Yeah.
Room 615 at the Millennium.
That's what I figured.
Yeah.
That's fantastic, Drew.
Yeah, I told you. Didn't I tell you didn't know anything about radio?
I didn't really think this thing is on.
All right. Well, if you don't think it's on, why do you punch it all the time?
Because who would hear it? What difference does it make?
All right. So Dicky is out here doing Jimmy's show, and this is really a great combination here.
I got to probably thank you, right?
No.
Well, I don't think Jimmy would have even known me if we weren't buddies.
Well, I can take some responsibility for that.
I was talking to Drew.
Yeah, oh, thank you, Adam.
Sorry, buddy. Dicky is doing a great job. Everyone's in love with him over there. And I am personally tickled pink because it's great to have Dicky in town as opposed to blowing through here once every couple of years or so. Yeah. And hung out, saw him last night at a party, hung out, watched football with him today at Jimmy's house.
I'm a man about town, a bit of a bon vivant, if you...
picked him up at a hotel other than the Roosevelt.
Yeah.
It was not the Roosevelt I picked him up at and drove him over here.
This is so great. I'm going to get calls in the morning and stuff.
Drove him out here tonight. And Dicky also is a part of a CD, which is out, right? Is it out?
I believe it's out. I don't know. I've got copies. I don't know. And I didn't get them.
It's a Santa Claus. It's... punk rock Christmas, and there's many bands that have been on this show in the past that are on here, like Newfound Glory, and of course Mighty Mighty Bosstones and MXPX and Something Corporate, and the list goes on and on. And I guess we'll hear something from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones and their contribution to this new Christmas CD. And all the money goes somewhere worthy, right, Drew?
Worthy.
Pediatric AIDS.
That's what I like. Just repeat the last word.
I want you to know something.
Yeah.
I heard a traffic report tonight about the Santa Monica Freeway.
Mm-hmm.
I watched the red light. I watched the brake lights. And look out for brake lights. Lo and behold, found them.
Mm-hmm.
Got off the freeway and got here. I would have been stuck. Would have been stranded.
Wow. Aided,
what's going on out there?
Aided by a traffic report. Yeah. All right. There's the first
time.
Everything.
That's right.
All right. So, but still not worth the $750 million you've heard up until this
it
one. That
feels, this
done
word,
nothing
this,
for you,
but this
right?
This is I think, the sort of reinforcing property to it all is that it felt like it.
Right.
It felt like it was the most important thing I'd ever heard.
All right.
And I would forever be dependent on radio, you know?
Should I get a car out here?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's people have been mentioning that to me.
Been walking.
I've been on foot. Well, I've been like my grandmother. People pick me up and drop me off. Who's picking up? Yeah, like if I go
watch
football.
You become a burden to your friends and family.
Yeah, I realize that.
You really do.
That's why I said my grandmother.
Picked them up on the way out here. Hey, Drew and I were at Kathy Griffin's party last night.
Pretty amazing party.
Dear friend.
How about that food?
And how about it?
That was great.
It was great?
Her grandmother, her mother, and her mother and her husband's mother made it.
Really?
Yeah.
What was it?
They baked some turkeys.
Swedish meatballs.
Made some meatballs. And had one thing I'd never seen before, which is macaroni and cheese hors d'oeuvres. Cut into squares and not really holding its shape too well, but you just grab a handful of greasy cheese and macaroni and throw it in your face. It was good. I mean, here's the thing. People, you know, hors d'oeuvres are like, you know, water cressin and water chestnut and all this kind of stuff, but nothing beats like... Still nothing really beats a, you know, pig in a blanket, right?
Right.
I mean, it just doesn't. You just don't want to say you serve that, but nothing tastes better than like macaroni and cheese, but... The bar was a little tough to get to.
Yeah, it was crowded.
Too many people hanging out at the bar.
A lot of Hollywood types.
There were hash brownies at the party I went to.
Adam was holding court in all the comedy writers. He was having a good time.
Yeah, I was having a good time. But he was. I'll tell you.
He's the king of them. I've seen him in action.
I was telling Dicky on the way out here that a little bar etiquette, which is get your goddamn drink and get the F out of there. A lot of people wait in line, and then they get their drink, and it's like, hey, it's my new home. It's in front of this bar. No, there's 70 people behind you that have a cotton mouth. They want to get their booze going.
Yeah, I could go back to where I originally was, but eventually I'm going to have to come back to the bar, so I might as well just park it here.
Right.
That's that attitude, right?
Now, nothing wrong with doubling down, knowing you may not be back for a while. That's what I'll do, a little two-fisted booze. Nothing wrong with that.
Everything you can carry, load up, but get out of the way.
Right.
All right, I'm with you on that.
All right, Dicky Barrett here tonight. We'll hear something from the Bosstones off the new Christmas album and a couple of few. Adrian?
Yeah?
You're 18?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Germany or Florida for you?
Oh, starting with a Germany or Florida. All right.
Okay.
Go ahead.
A girl goes to a free clinic and picks up birth control pills. She comes back a couple of months later and tries to sue them because she says she's pregnant. And then so they go to court. And then it turns out that instead of taking the pills orally, she was shoving them up her vagina.
I've heard a weed.
No, that's not a weed laugh.
That isn't?
No.
That's just I'm going to take over the world one day.
Yes,
I'm stroking a Persian
mad
cat
scientist
laugh.
Yes. Yeah. So you can actually produce a sound when he laughs.
Yeah. Okay. So here's the thing, Adrian. I don't think. I'm thinking Florida because, A, Germans kill people with under 100 IQ. That I know.
But
the
also,
Gypsies, Jews, and dumb people, they don't tolerate them over there. And the other thing is I think they kill you if you try to sue for frivolous lawsuits over there, too.
They don't have free clinics because they have state health care.
Yeah, the frivolous lawsuit thing, that's something that's American.
And I've heard this story as sort of a urban legend. Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
So we'll go Florida.
We're going Florida.
Florida. You got it.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Adrian, what a thespian this Adrian is.
Florida.
He says it like he's just dramatic pause. It back to you, like, are you doing Florida? Like, how is it that people lose control of inflection? Do you know what
they
I mean?
Lose control over it. They
never
had
have it. They don't have inflection.
Florida. And you got it.
Listen, everybody. If there's long pauses after words you say where the other person's supposed to say something, that means you're not hitting it right.
Now, what he was doing was like in, you know, step forward with the real Adam, please stand for, and then it was a dramatic kind of Florida.
Mm-hmm. Right, he was being, he was working, yeah.
All right. So anyway, it is Florida. Yeah, I don't think. Did you hear the story, by the way, that there's a woman who took a spill in Walmart because they put something on sale? They put a DVD on sale, a DVD player on sale for like $29, and she got knocked down. But then it turns out that's her 8th lawsuit against Walmart, and her 16th overall.
Oof.
And how come all that stuff is never sort of germane in court? You know what I mean? Like, the fact that OJ's wife had a whole bunch of calls into 911 thing, this guy's going to kill me, her showing up with black knives and black eyes and like arrows going through her head, like Steve Martin stuff. It's like, yeah, that's not admissible.
Oh, no.
That's not admissible.
No, of course not. It's a system.
You wouldn't want to.
It'd violate the system.
You wouldn't want to establish a pattern. It's not admissible. Yeah, you can't go off.
It has nothing to do.
Yeah, you know what it's going to do
with this DVD situation.
If you find out that the guy was beating the holy hell out of his wife over the last 5 years, and that she'd made multiple calls saying she thought he was going to kill, if you find that out, it may taint
the jury.
It may
taint the opinion.
It. Yeah, it should. Shouldn't that? Don't we need that kind of tainting?
Right.
Don't we need the one where he's announced, "I'm going to kill you" many times? If we then find her body, isn't that why you're not supposed to announce that? Really? Yeah, no, we can't let him find. We can't let him find out about anything. How about we don't let him know the guy's name or what happened? How about don't turn the lights on?
Yeah.
And by the way, no evidence. We're just going to, here's what we're going to do.
Let the jury look at him decide.
We're going to put you in a shopping cart. We're going to put a tarp over it. We're going to roll you down the pier into the ocean.
Let's not tell the jury why they're even here.
You don't know what you're here for.
Guilty or not guilty.
Just guilty or not. What is it?
Coin toss.
Is it a woman? No, you don't get to know.
We don't want to taint you.
We don't want to taint you with information. Really can't. And here's the whole thing. Do we care if on your 8th lawsuit it was a legitimate one? Or shouldn't we just beat the crap out of you for that as a lesson to it, well, you shouldn't have screwed around. Well, here's the deal with the 8 lawsuits. Either you were lying on the first 7.
And we should beat you up for that.
And we should beat you up for that. And part of the way we beat you up, it's, you know, the boy who cried wolf or the girl who cried wolf. Or you're defective in some way. Maybe you're cursed. Yeah. You have horrible luck. But we can't compensate you for being cursed, can we? That every time you go into Walmart, you legitimately fall down? Drew, when you say something a little wrong with the gyroscope in the head or something?
Oh, yes.
Do we need to pay for that? That's my whole thing. Hey. My whole thing is if I back into you at a mile and a half and there's no damage done to the car, but you say you can't work anymore because your neck has now been destroyed, that means you're faulty, right?
Yeah.
I can hit you on the shoulder, Drew. You're fine, right?
Yep.
Now, if your shoulder came out of socket and you said you couldn't work anymore, that'd be your fault.
Yeah.
Because I hit you in an acceptable way.
Yeah.
See what I'm saying, Drew?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Why don't we just go, you're defective?
Yeah.
There's no damage done to the car. How can there be damage done to the neck? Either you're lying or you're defective. And if you're defective, we can't compensate for that.
Like after the third or fourth time, the judge would say, well, for your own safety, you're not allowed to go to Walmart.
Well, that's the point. After the first time, Walmart should be well within its rights to go. That's it.
Yeah. Sorry.
Well, that's it. No, then you've got another lawsuit.
And then start profiling. Anyone who acts like that person doesn't come here either.
Please.
Why not? It pays a business.
You and your family are not allowed here. It's for your own safety.
Yeah, right.
Here's the deal. As you know, I've said this many times. You get 3 calls to 911 every 10 years. Fourth time, cop puts a bullet in your head. And I'll have
I don't think I've ever called 911.
That's my point.
That's the point. Yeah.
Neither have I. Right. No one's ever called 911. No, normal people don't call. Once in a while, you see a guy who looks like he's having some trouble on the side of the road. Right, you may phone it in for him. Right. But the guys who are using the cops as their own personal marital counselors.
Security force.
The security force, yeah. They get a bullet. And then how many lawsuits? I'd say you get
two
every 20 years.
Yeah. Plenty.
Have you had any?
Plenty. No.
I threaten a lot, but I never really follow through.
Never. Dicky, be careful.
I just kill you. You know, off the top of my head.
Yeah, I understand, but Adam still might kill you.
How about 411? I call that an awful lot.
Is
that okay?
That's expensive. As many as you like. Expensive. Yeah. I've never sued anybody, and I've never called 911.
Seriously, Adam might kill you if you keep talking about suing people.
No, I'm
just telling you.
Just
be careful.
You know.
Be careful.
But he doesn't do it. That's
or
the
I could
point.
Go back to my old ways and hit a guy.
Amy?
That's fine with you, Drew.
Amy, you're 23.
I am.
What's happening?
Last night there was a girl that called in and she was asking a question if her boyfriend really had an orgasm when he pulled out and nothing came out. And Dr. Drew answered that. But then the second part of that was, why would you let a guy do that? And I have an answer to that.
Let me just hang on. That was a question I've never seen addressed. And I find it terribly curious, and I was genuinely curious. What is in it for a woman to have? Oh. Adam was talking about blowing snot rockets, if you recall, as a way of sort of simulating orgasm for a guy that couldn't achieve one for a woman that wanted this effect
in the doggy position
right? So she couldn't see this where the goo was emerging from,
okay.
right?
And my question was,
Dicky's done it. He knows,
of course. Who hasn't? And my question was, and I'm genuinely curious about this. What do you get out of that?
Why
would a woman want that?
Why would a woman want to become a jizz trough? Right? Well, I mean, why do you want somebody to finish up on you? And Amy.
Why? Amy has an answer for it.
Amy's got an answer. Go ahead.
Okay, for me personally, if I'm having sex and not using a condom, then if he's going to finish, but I'm not finished yet, then, you know, there's going to be the refractory period and we're going to go again. However, if he's already come inside me, the consistency is such that it doesn't feel the same for me.
Okay.
So I would rather have him pull out, do his thing, and then we'll go again.
Yeah, but doing his thing could be into the planter or the sheets. Yeah. Or it doesn't have to be on you.
You got the dog. You got the picture of the Virgin Guadalupe there on the side of the bed. I like the jizz on that. Yeah, you got everything. I mean, everything. You got whatever's by the side of the bed.
Amy, you like it on
you? Reading lamps?
Well, I don't like it on me, but...
That's my question. That's okay, fine. Okay. Then women should speak up about that a little bit, because I think men may be sort of ill-conceived about that.
Yeah, right. Grab a towel. It's no big deal. I mean, you're right there. You don't want to have him jump up and run into the...
Yeah, he could have grabbed the towel, too, and it sort of...
No big deal.
Yeah, no big deal. That's
no, listen, Amy's a cracker jack and a fat chick. I like that. Your game. Your big gown?
Yeah. Not huge.
Medium big, though.
Sure.
Yeah. Listen, well, first off, hold on. We'll get Amy's dimensions. First off, when you're a petite gal, it's relative. You get hit with a couple of ropes, it engulfs your whole body.
Yeah, you're swimming.
Yeah, right. You're swimming. You're swimming in semen.
Good point.
Now, you're like a manatee who's sunning on a rock. You get hit with that. That's nothing. That's nothing. Like when I say a rhino has a bird laying on it, doesn't even know the bird's on him.
Yeah.
But you're size of a house cat, bird lands on you, you goddamn know there's a bird on you. So I don't even know if they know there's a bird on them. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I see the metaphor, yes.
But I also, it also means they're good to go. Even they're more versatile.
They tolerate
more
a lot.
They're more durable.
Yeah, yeah.
Bigger gals are more sexually hardy.
Open to diversity or something,
And they're not whiners.
Yeah.
You can take them camping. Amy?
Yeah.
What size are you?
14.
14. Mm-hmm. All right. That's, how tall are you?
5'9".
5'9". How much you weigh?
165.
Okay. 165. Let me do a little radio math here. All right. Hold on a second. 5'9", 165. Okay. I got 5'7", and 11/16", and 181. Okay? Mm. All right. And again, that you can't argue with the radio math. Amy?
What's that?
You can't argue with the radio math. All right. Well,
she sounds
time.
Like a real nice person.
Yeah. Thank you for enlightening us. Yeah. And she's calling for our own benefit, not for her.
She sounds intelligent, right. And there's
You just keep a chamois near the bed.
Yeah.
All right?
Okay.
Stand all up for yourself. Keep a towel in handy. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about.
No, listen. I don't need a woman to enjoy whatever disgusting act I'd like to perform on her. I just wanted to do it. I need to tolerate it.
Yeah, right. But my question, I understand that, but some of these callers were like, oh, this is what they were looking forward to. And I thought, what, really? You really? Or is that just BS?
Yeah, I think certain women enjoy knowing that something was produced, that it's like,
yeah, but does
this
it have
is
to,
the physical manifestation of this man's pleasure.
They should check the towel then.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Let me say this, though, too. I think women have a higher tolerance for that kind of stuff than guys do. Straight guys. I mean, like baby poop and that sort of stuff.
You know what? I think you're right. I think that's why a girl talks sometimes a little more disgustingly than guys.
No,
I saw a cute movie at the Roosevelt the other day, and they really seemed to be enjoying it.
They're going at each other? They were doing like a bukkake.
They seemed, as it happened, they seemed to have absolutely no problem and actually seemed to be enjoying it.
In the porno you're watching.
Oh, is it a porno? It was a story about some college girls.
Dicky, what kind of bill have you run up on the Spectrovision?
Now, here's the way I figure it out. This is the way I do this. Let me do this math for you, okay? Yeah. And I'll be honest. It's Jimmy Kimmel's picking up the room.
Right.
Okay? So the way I look at it, it's like $12.50 a day in the room.
For the Spectrovision.
For me. That's what I'm paying for a hotel room, yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah. So you're picking up the
That's how I justify it, yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
I can't run that bill by
Yeah.
But plus the $30 bag of potato chips they eat late at night, and
There's nothing worse than the drunken mini bar rape that ends up costing like $46 for some
stuff
honey
you wouldn't buy at the
nuts
store
that you forgot you ate. Yeah. Yeah.
Toblerone.
But you know what? There's a comedy in this, and that is. Fast forward 10 years ago, 5 years ago, you look at that mini bar, you go, oh my God, $10 for bed. No way.
Yeah.
Then you break through, and now you don't even think about it. It's just game on.
Once you pop your mini bar hymen, it's game on.
You don't think about it anymore. You know you're having $30 potato chips, but...
The thing about it is I know I'm having $30 potato chips, and I also know that an elevator ride away, I can saw that thing to a fraction of the price.
Let me tell you something. There's nothing. You're
right downstairs is a 24-hour store.
Something I still can't get used to is other people getting into my mini bar. And, Drew, you've not experienced that. I know you wouldn't tolerate it. Well, you travel with the likes of Daniel, who was the executive on The Man Show, and guys like
Bosstones.
Jimmy or the Bosstones.
Great umbrage.
You travel around with these guys, and they'll come piling in your room at some point. And sometimes I got a couple buddies. Like when I was in Chicago, it's like, hey, that's Murph and Sully. Hey, come on down. He said, and then they screw around. They go, hey, Murph, what do you want? You want a stoli or something? They open the thing. Ah, put me down for one. And next thing you know, there's drinks going around, and it's all out of your mini bar. And wait till Daniel slides in and says, the liquor store is closed, the strippers are getting antsy, and I need everything in the mini bar, and actually cleans out your entire mini bar, and you know, like makes a basket out of his t-shirt, and just just
little bottles of
many things of like Kahlua mudslides and Toblerones and Smokehouse almonds, and it's all and like oh my
Altoids.
God,
you took the Altoids, comb.
He's got $2,800
Q-tips
in his t-shirt. It's really $14 worth of crap.
Yeah. Daniel, what do you need the sewing kit for?
Hey, buddy, don't worry about it. Oh, that's brutal.
Yeah.
That is brutal.
You know, funny, my kids do that to me.
All right.
They don't talk. They leave out the stripper part.
I did that to the boss.
They clean it out.
Oh.
Let's take a break.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
No. Lee?
Yes.
Let me say something. I just had a thought. I don't know why, but we're talking about big women.
Yeah.
And, I thought of this thing I was telling Jimmy about last week, which is he was telling me that Oprah was in Africa. And I thought, if you're fat, you should have to say she's on Africa. And anyone who travels who's over, like, let's say 250 pounds, like if a fat chick goes to Canada, you can't say she's in Canada. You go, she's on Canada. And that would be our subtle little jab at fatties, you know, and incentive. By the way, and here's the thing, though. If it was a guy or a girl, you know, if the guy was like 6'8 and he was 250 pounds, he wouldn't get the on. We'd work out some sort of body fat, you know, versus height versus age. We'd work it out. But when you got to a certain point, you'd have to say on. And it'd be a law that you'd have to say on.
I don't want you to tell the guys at work this. And I don't like her. I'm not a fan. I think Oprah gets a bad rap.
Yeah. For the weight thing?
Yeah, I think there's probably other fatter people we could go to.
There are.
But Oprah seems to take...
But not fatter, not richer.
She sets herself up for it a bit by making a big deal about losing and gaining and losing and gaining.
Oh, yeah.
And if she just lost and kept it, I don't think anybody would say a thing. What would you say?
Yeah.
Is she fat or not fat
now? She's not that
fat. It's hard to tell.
But I'm real fat.
She would make it into the on... She might make it into the on. She might make it in the on Africa category. Or Canada, or wherever you happen to be. Dicky is here from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones. He's got a new CD that he's a part of called Santa Claus.
Got a new job.
It's a punk rock Christmas. Also got a new job as the announcer on Jimmy Kimmel Live. We're tickled pink about that. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Hello. This is your radio. LoveLine will be right back.
Every hour, two Americans under the age of 25 are infected with HIV. Protect yourself. Call toll-free 1-866-344-KNOW.
Love Line. With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. 105 Alternative. San Francisco.
Hey, everybody. Love Line. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dicky Barrett is here tonight from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones and the new announcer for Jimmy Kimmel Live. Oh, yes. We're going to hear something off a Santa Claus, which is a punk rock Christmas CD, which the Bosstones are on. It's a compilation. It is out. And
it's on Immortal Records. These are the bullet points they gave me.
Blink 182, Newfound Glory, something corporate.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And the proceeds go to the Pediatric AIDS Foundation. And I guess www.pediatrics.org.
Those are great.
And by the way, www.bosstones.com if you want to find anything about the Bosstones or pediatric AIDS.
Thank you, buddy.
All right. Should we? Tomorrow night, Nicole Richie from The Simple Life is going to be in here.
Are you kidding me?
No. Yeah. I mean,
you'll be here too.
Yeah.
I just might tag along.
She's coming in. The show did gangbusters in the ratings two nights it was on.
What are you going to do?
All right, so we'll talk to her tomorrow night. So anyway, Lee.
Yes.
21.
Yes.
Guys see you as a friend or a sex object, but not a girlfriend.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I try not to let them see me as a sex object, you know. I've only been with two guys.
All right. 21. And what about So what? And the other guys see you as a friend. They're not interested physically.
Right.
Well, tell me more about the friendships. How do they develop? Are you part of a group? Or are they just guys that start dating you and then end up in Friendville? What's the story?
I don't date at all. I don't know.
How come? Why?
Just see me as a friend, you know, just hang out.
Whoa, hold on. Why don't you date?
I don't know.
Why don't you ask guys out?
Huh?
Why don't you ask guys out?
Yeah.
I'm really scared of that sort of thing.
All right. Is there anything wrong with you we need to know about?
I don't think so, no. Not that I'm aware of.
And what do you do? Do you work?
Yes, I work. I'm a bartender on the weekends, and I go to college full-time through the week.
Junior college?
Huh?
Junior college?
No, sir. It's culinary arts.
Culinary arts. All right. So you basically have fags and the morbidly obese to choose from at school.
Right, yeah.
But at work?
Uh-huh.
Or the gay morbidly obese? Filled with semen,
and,
girl.
Like,
you pop them,
guys.
And it's just a spring of semen. Like, remember what happened to Rod Stewart? He had to have his stomach pumped because
of
all that semen.
That, of course.
Yeah. So, listen, Lee, what about the guys at the bar? If you're a bartender, aren't guys hitting on you all night long?
I don't know. Sometimes I get compliments. I just take it as they're trying to make me feel better. I really feel better?
What's the matter?
What are you feeling bad about?
I don't really know.
Why would they want to make you feel better and not want to make you feel sort of attractive or let you know that they're interested in you? Isn't that more what guys are trying to do?
I really don't know. I just take it as they're trying to make me like feel better about myself.
Why are you feeling bad about yourself?
I don't know. I've always had a really low opinion on myself.
All right, hold on a second. All right. She's
Campbell?
She's not a smart chick. But that doesn't matter. Do you think Claudia Schiffer's smart? You know what I mean?
No, I'm getting like neglect. Like the engine's not running right.
Yeah. Like, and maybe a lazy eye. One that shuts halfway. But yeah.
Bad
dad stuff. Wounded.
Right.
After
she did get, whatever.
Crushed her self-esteem.
Smashed her, yeah.
Yeah. To hell, Lee. Let's try to figure out what happened to her dad. Where's your dad?
My dad is at his home.
In Florida?
No, not in Florida. In
Germany?
Missouri.
In Missouri.
Ha. Ah.
Yes. Uh-huh. And
Florida, Missouri.
And is he in your life or is he out of your life?
He's in my life totally, yeah.
Did you grow up around him?
Yeah. Well, my parents divorced when I was very young, so I saw him on the weekends.
Why did they divorce?
I really don't know. I never bothered to ask about it. It's not really any of my business.
Drew, it's a little bit of your business. But hold on, Drew. You see, your parents didn't divorce.
I understand.
It would have been nice if they did and left the state. Should see his mom. She has a couple of highballs. I was a flapper in the 20s. I toured with Guy Lombardo. But listen, here's the point. All right, look. Here's what I'm saying. My parents had the quiet dignity to break up. They both realized they're horrible people that didn't deserve a mate. And they broke up.
Oh, my God.
Well, they had enough dignity to know that neither one of them was worthy of having anyone like
Strangely, they both found mates subsequently, strangely enough.
Yeah.
Those are people they're married to now, yes? I understand the jury's out as far as you're concerned.
No. I mean, yeah, after they got a little recovery and got their ass together, some years later, they were able to hook up again with very tolerant people. But I'm just saying at the time, they were, you know, no good for anybody. But I don't know why they broke up. You know, you think kids know why their parents break up when they're six?
Well, sometimes
they
do. Sometimes they do.
Oh, yeah, if dad's beating mom in a bullwhip or
something.
That's
the question I'm asking. Did she see some violence or something? And was your mom around? Was she good to you when you were growing up?
Well, not really. Every day she always said something about what I was wearing, what I ate. Yeah. You know, I didn't have enough makeup on, wasn't dressed right.
Right. So I just get, did you have an eating disorder one time?
I used to.
Right. There we go.
Not enough makeup on, though, for the young girl. Like, honey, do you want to go outside not looking like a slut?
Yeah.
Now you get back in here and put them false eyelashes in and shove a couple of softballs in your bra.
Eyeliner's not blue enough.
Yeah, and go ahead and use the eraser from the pencil. It'll act as nipples. So duct tape those to the softballs. Now get out there and turn some tricks.
Yeah, Lee, so you were sort of beaten up by your mom, and you didn't get attunement. You weren't supported. There wasn't a good connection with your mom. Your dad was absent, and that's how.
My dad's awesome. I love my dad. My dad's totally awesome. But
that's good that you have that now. And your mom's what?
My mom. I don't know. just all the time. She was obsessing about my weight totally every day.
Yeah. All right. That screwed you up.
Yeah.
Okay. How about a little therapy? Use some of that bar money to talk to a shrink.
Yeah. The reason guys are not getting involved with you is not really that guys are not getting involved with you. It's you're not getting involved with them. You're not making yourself available. You're not going. You're not picking up on cues and going to the next stage with things. Yeah. Naturally enough, you don't feel you're worth it. Naturally enough, relationships mean pain and vulnerability. Naturally enough, you would be sort of close to that sort of thing. Of course, you would probably seek guys that are unavailable and abusive. I'm surprised you haven't gone into that phase yet.
Yeah, she will. God willing.
But she can't attract those guys.
She's one of these chicks that looks like a bad rope bridge. Like, you see you're you know those movies. You're in the canyon, you're hiking, you know. You
where
see,
are we going here?
I'll tell you where we're going. You see on the other side of the canyon.
Is it a Roadrunner cartoon?
On the other side of the valley, you see a beautiful lagoon that you want to swim in, and you start to make out, and then you see the rickety rope bridge, and you go like,
You step on a few bricks, it cracks, you step back onto terra firma,
and you think, I'm just going to keep walking till I see another bridge. It looks all right. See, she's a woman. She's a little dainty. She's
a lot of work.
She's a lot of work. She's damaged goods. Mm-hmm. Guys wouldn't mind effing her. That's the lagoon on the other side, but that rope bridge is too much. It's too much hassle.
Guys
don't want a lot of work.
Well, they
guys smell trouble.
They smell trouble
in maintenance.
Yeah,
in work emotionally, they'll go.
When they think somebody's going to start becoming stalking,
unless you're super hot,
then
you can do whatever you want.
Yeah,
all the time.
That's what I'm saying. Those guys, she doesn't attract those a-hole guys.
Right, they're not quite hot enough for those guys.
All right.
Hey, listen, that's fine. We're not all models, you know what I'm saying?
But that's how those women get screwed up.
Yeah.
Right? They're actually the rickety bridge, and they have guys just pouring over it, just the thing collapsing into the canyon.
I don't know what you're talking about. Is that until my analogy? Yes. Are you actually talking about a bridge? How about we hear a song?
Great.
Yeah?
Yes.
It's off the newish CD. It's been out about 3 weeks.
For me. It has?
Well,
where'd you get that information?
It says it came out on the 11th of November. What's coming on
how's
to
it, how's
coming
it
on to month?
How's that thing moving?
These are the only two they've sold so far.
Well, these weren't actually sold. They weren't actually sold.
Oh, well, then none. Yeah. They haven't sold any.
It's for a good cause.
Yeah, it's for a great cause. Yeah. It's for vehicular AIDS.
Let me read this again.
It's true. Kit from Knight Rider, the car, it's got AIDS.
It's got AIDS. That's good.
Yeah.
Kidding me? Really?
It's for pediatric AIDS.
Drew?
Yeah. It's for pediatric AIDS.
Got my kids.
Stop talking to Dicky while I'm talking to Dicky.
Oh, buddy.
Don't sign anything for his kids. And he always does that. It's for the kids. He doesn't have kids. I'm sorry, Drew. I'm not going to go along with a charade
He's
anymore.
He's a buddy of mine.
He's got a hot, three-looking, you know, he has good-looking blonde pictures in his wallet of these kids.
Yeah.
They're the ones that come with the frame.
No.
You know when you buy a frame? Yeah, that's what you get. No. All right, let's hear.
See our family photos this year. They're going
to
piss you off.
What are you guys doing?
We're just at the beach, and we took these great pictures.
Sweat is tied around your neck.
But Adam always wanted to be part of a family in a photograph growing up.
Are you sitting on the rocks?
Yes.
You are?
Yeah, of course.
All right.
All of us?
Right. Hey, look, hold on a second. Don't send out those Christmas cards at you and your good-looking family having a great time in sunny Southern California.
The Kennedys or something like a nice...
It's obnoxious. It makes people feel bad.
It makes you feel bad.
I want to be a part of. Send one over to the Roosevelt, will you?
Wait,
the W, you're the W, aren't you?
And they'll forward it ahead to Sharon.
Down to the Mondrian.
Yeah,
there we go.
All right.
Let's hear a song, Mighty Mighty Bosstones, a little Christmas song.
Why I love this time of year. It's spending it with you. That keeps me looking forward to. Looking forward to this time of year. It gets me, and it never lets me act like I don't care. It's time of year, my favorite time of year.
That is the Mighty Mighty Bosstones. Dicky Barrett of the Mighty Mighty Bosstones and of the Jimmy Kimmel Show. He is the new...
so funny.
The new announcer. Looking good and representing. Oh, yes. And Drew, maybe one day you'll be asked back on the show.
Ooh.
Don't get your hopes
I
up.
I won't.
You've been on?
Yeah.
Surprising.
In emergencies.
Man. Yeah. They get really stuck.
Some like a no name drops out, they'll
really stuck. Terribly stuck. Yeah. You had me sing on the show first time.
Feel like Regis in New York. If they're stuck for a guest on any of those shows, they
get Regis.
Yeah,
in.
Yeah.
Except
they don't even really have your number. They call Adam. Can you can you get your buddy down here?
No, they do. They do. They go. Do you think Drew would do? I'm like, Drew will fly to Kentucky to pick up a nickel.
Nah.
He will. Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
You're so jealous, it's sickening.
You really? Dick, will you come here every night?
I'll tell you who I'm jealous of. I'm jealous of me.
You should be jealous of me.
I'm jealous of you
only
because
you're jealous.
I've
got the easiest job in the world.
Because you have a relationship with Adam.
Yeah.
That's why he's jealous of you.
You get to know what it's like to hang. You get to hang out with me, whereas I'm just hang out in me. You understand?
Do you really feel that way?
Let's go to break. Let's talk about this.
Is he?
We'll take a quick break.
Tell me during the smoke.
And we'll be right back.
LoveLine.
1-800-LOVE-191.
Hey, everybody. It's LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. All right, Drew. Don't do your homework during the show.
You got it.
Dear friend, Dicky Barrett from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones.
Oh, thank you.
And Jimmy Kimmel Live now. Yeah, doing the announcing.
Wow.
Nightly.
Oh, that's my new one. Wow.
Looks very comfortable. Slid into his comfort zone. Barely looking down at the cue card he's got in his hand now. He's got his dapper. He's got the tie on.
Nice.
Sometimes an ascot. How about an ascot, Dicky?
Ascot.
Spyro shirt. Puppy
Spats.
Shirt.
I could see you.
Puffy
I could
shirt?
See you with that.
Maybe spats and maybe some sort of a hat.
I was saying today, I don't see enough of those starched, remember the starched tuxedo sort of vest that when you hit the high note, it would roll up like a window shade? Why is it almost everything rolled up like a window shade when I was a kid? Like your tongue could roll up. Like anything I pulled on could roll up. Like, Drew, if you stuck your tongue out and I grabbed it and pulled it and let it
go. Like a shade.
Yeah, anything. Your ear, your, I'm not sure. I've never seen it done with the sack area, but I'm sure
it could happen.
I'm sure it could. All right. Everything except for, ironically, the window shades, which you just keep tugging on and never actually made their move. All right. Let's talk to Andre, who's 16. Andre?
Hi.
Hi.
About a year ago, I had sex in the river, but I did not come. And my girlfriend, who I'm with right now, was wondering if I'm still a virgin or not. Kind of important to her.
She wants to. I see. She wants to know if you're a virgin.
That's about a year ago.
Here's the deal, Andre.
Still with the same.
If you break the plane of the vagina, neither of you are virgins.
Whoa!
Forget the exchange of fluids. All the penis inserts into the vagina. Even if it immediately runs away, you are no longer a virgin.
Wow.
This guy.
Even if it was a year ago.
just wanted to know because,
This guy's sort of a Bing Crosby meets Don Ho.
Mahababo.
Hey, Andre?
Yeah.
You're still with the girl?
No, this was like a one night stand at the river.
The river.
At the river.
Yeah. Take me to the river.
That is albino trash. Let me explain the white trash progression. Ocean, it depends how much time you spend. And if you spend a lot of time in a body of water, you're sort of white
trailer
trash.
At the ocean or camper at the ocean.
But,
like Rockford.
Yeah. But the lake, white trash, but the river, super albino trash. You know what I mean? The river is going down to the river.
You know, I can take it one step further.
What?
What's... In my town, it was the swamp.
Oh, the bog.
But it's a New England swamp, so it wasn't like
New England, they have bogs. They don't have swamps.
It's actually where the pool, the town pool, emptied into the woods, and it became a swamp. Yeah.
Town pool.
Yeah. I still have buddies that are drinking.
Town pool goes up with the river, too, as far as I'm concerned.
The town pool.
Yeah, it's too bad. Like, your folks won't let you get loaded at the house. So you got to go to places and drink. You got to go to reservoirs and stuff.
You lived in Boston, didn't you?
I lived in Norwood outside of, about 15 minutes outside. Norwood. At a town pool.
Yeah. Jennifer? Yeah.
And I'm staying at the Roosevelt, by the way, if you didn't hear catch the beginning of the show.
Jennifer?
Yeah.
You're 21?
That's right.
What's up?
Well, first of all, I want to say, Drew and Adam, I've been listening to you since I was like 11.
Wow.
I love you guys.
Thank you.
And Dicky, your voice is like vicious. I love it.
Wow.
Oh, thank you.
In a good way.
Right.
Yeah, no, that's a good thing.
Thank you.
Vicious, yeah. Cool.
Right.
Like wicked.
Thank you. You put it in Boston terms. Thank you, Drew, for translating.
So you're anorexic and bulimic?
Well, yeah, I kind of... Over the years, I've kind of oscillated between the two of them.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, anorexic. I haven't had a period in about 7 months.
Well, see, there is a plus to this. And what about it? How much do you weigh?
Do I have to say?
Yes.
Well, on Friday when I weighed... I haven't weighed myself since Friday, but...
Okay.
I was about 117.
How tall are you?
5'10" and a half.
Yeah, that's lanky.
Wow.
But since then, she's eaten a couple of peanuts that she found between the crack of her car seat, so she may have packed on another few pounds. Are you throwing up every time you eat?
No, she's just anorexic. She said
just
no.
Doesn't eat?
Yeah.
Right.
And what's your question?
Oh.
Am I going to be able to have children later? Because I do plan on getting well at some point.
How about now?
Well, I can't afford health insurance right now.
Mm. Yeah, but just how about go to a 12-step meeting or an OA or community-based support of one type or another? If you're ready to get well, there's help out there. That's not your question. Let me just answer your question. You've not had a period in 7 months?
Right.
Okay, and that is a response. That's how your body responds to this tremendous weight loss. Amenorrhea is what that's called, or oligomenorrhea, and that's very, very common in bulimics. And that usually restores itself. People do start cycling, having their periods again.
Why? However, why do that? Your body's saying we're going to hang on to our nutrients.
Basically, that's right. You're certainly not going to get pregnant.
You know, you're not.
Your body's saying
we're not going to get pregnant. And what about the not getting rid of the blood?
And
too?
Not getting rid of whatever, with hanging on to everything it possibly can.
That's what happens when you're constipated too, right?
Same thing. Yeah, same thing.
Your body says, I got to hold on to this Duke.
That's
But why do fat people get constipated? Oh, we'll talk off the air.
Please.
All right.
I don't want to confuse people.
Go ahead.
But in fact, though, Jennifer, bulimic anorectics are at risk for premature ovarian failure. So it's not necessarily the case that your ovaries will turn back on again. You may hit a menopause, basically, at some point. And every day that passes that your disease is active puts you at added risk.
So you bring on early menopause.
Exactly. I've seen that.
Oh, and during the holidays, that's got to be the worst time for this this disease. Jennifer.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. What's a normal day for you? You get up in the morning. What will you eat?
Not if I can help it.
You might not eat the whole day?
Well, I haven't eaten anything since Friday.
Mm. Nothing solid has passed your lips.
Right.
Now, let me ask you, I got a theory about this. People with big heads get this disease.
What?
Uh-huh.
They just look like they have big heads because everybody else is so drawn.
No. I've done some research about this. Women on TV, especially, get this. Here's what it is. Some people have heads that look bigger than their body, or look fuller than their body.
Yeah.
And the only way to get their head to look right, like when it's on camera, is to starve their body.
Yeah.
Their head will be the last thing to go.
That may be something that
like that. What's her name on Facts of Life? No, Different Strokes. No. What's that Alan Thicke show where, whatever that, well, you know, there's a chick that has, she had it. Yeah. And she's one of these chicks where she, when she was a normal weight, she looked at, what show was it?
Growing pains.
Who is this kid over here?
That's
Herman, 3 months. He yelled growing pains at me. Yeah, that's what it is. All right, she's got to go to OA.
Yeah.
She's got to get some
help.
She
needs some treatment.
Please. Yeah.
There are eating, there are 12-step meetings out there that are specifically for people with eating disorder. Check it out.
All right. Well, I'll explain my theory about people thin faces getting fat asses in the next
Fantastic.
Break. Dickie's here from the Bosstones. Take a quick break. We'll be right back.
All right, guys, here's the deal. Looking to hook up? Call the Dateline. Sick of wasting time with the wrong person?
Call the Dateline.
One call's all you need to make.
Call the Dateline.
1-877-889-DATE.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline.
Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Nicole Richie's in here tomorrow night from The Simple Life. And Dicky Barrett is in here tonight from, of course, the Mighty Mighty Bosstones. And now
from the even simpler life.
The Jimmy Kimmel Live show where he's doing some announcing and doing a fine job. Also, the CD, it's a compilation CD that he's on, is called A Santa Cause, and it's for pediatric AIDS. It's out, and it's got Blink-182 and Newfound Glory and something corporate on it and a bunch of other bands that have all contributed. So I predict this can be a collector's item one day.
I would think. It's all Christmas music, right?
Yeah.
Like bands everyone loves.
Yeah. And,
let's get on this thing.
Yeah, let's go, kids. Don't you or don't you care about the kids?
The pediatric AIDS. Who cares?
Kids care about cares? The kids?
Yeah. Sorry, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I think most of our audience may be confused by the pediatric AIDS.
Children with AIDS.
Oh, that's kids.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Not foot AIDS.
Right. Right. Oh, yeah, yeah. Because like
podiatric AIDS. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. You ready to rock here?
Yeah.
Let's talk to David, who's 21. David.
How's it going?
Good. What's up?
Oh, well, I have been seeing, I'm 21, I'm a virgin. I've been seeing my psychologist and been pretty depressed this past week. And I lost my grandmother in January, and Thanksgiving was usually the time we saw her. And basically the conversation in my last session went from talking about her and missing her to what are the reasons I'm feeling depressed. And one of them, one of the questions my doctor asked me was, am I still interested in sex the same way as I have been the last 6 months? And he said, and I told him that not as much, but I usually am only aroused when I'm watching pornography or pornographic movies or videos.
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, how often is that? And I said, well, I can't remember the last time that I haven't masturbated without having porn or anything like that around.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, that's what prison and camping is for.
Don't do much camping, and I don't want to go to prison, so I try to keep away
from so you don't have any relationships?
I've never had a relationship, never kissed a girl, nothing.
Well, see, that's the thing, too. He doesn't have anything in his hopper to drum up.
He just has a bunch in his hamper.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but his history is his closet where he keeps the porn.
Right.
He can't do that.
Hold on, there's no day. Closet. There's no closet, Adam. It's all on digital form on my computer or on my TiVo.
God. Kids are so lucky these days.
Oh, my God.
Aren't they?
We had nothing.
Yeah.
Well, David, but are you spending all your time and money and that sort of thing with porn, or is it just that you don't have relationships and that's more what we should be focusing on?
Which is the cart and which is the horse?
Right. His balls, I think, are the
horse.
Wait a minute. Yeah, I think they'd be the horse. Horse penis is the cart.
I don't think I'm spending all my money on it. No, I mean I have high speed internet where most.
In other words, I get that. What I'm asking you is, you could stop doing that enough to go out and have a date and that sort of thing. It's not as though you couldn't stop.
Do you have to beat off on the date?
No.
I mean, on the date.
No. Doesn't sound like a sex addict.
Yeah, he does.
Sex addicts don't laugh like
no,
that.
No, he's a nerd who's and here's the other thing too. Excuse me, but I gotta go on a quick jag here, which is you have this option.
Right.
I mean, God knows where a young bashful Drew, although he's a man of exquisite passion, but even a young bashful Adam or a young bashful Dicky, if you had this magic box that was filled with every nude woman in the world doing all sorts of crazy things with a penis, it would have been easy just to retreat to that and then never leave, right?
Absolutely.
But you had nothing, so you had to go out and try to, you know, it's
eventually you'd wear the magazine out and you'd have to leave the house.
Right. That's what we had. Yeah. And they don't have these. It's an unlimited stream, and it's new, by the way. It's all... I mean, you know, you just hop on the internet and you find something that wasn't there yesterday.
Right.
What about this, Drew? I've often thought this for myself. You give yourself a time limit. See, here's where the trouble...
Well, that's the point.
If
he can't do it, if he can't structure it, if he's unable to, then that's a problem.
Yeah, here's where the trouble starts with almost everything, which is you get these ideas and next thing you know, 2 minutes turns into 2 hours, turns into 2 days. If you just beat yourself off in the first 5 minutes, you're done. You're freed up. You can move on.
Your solution to this is finish fast.
Hurry it up.
Finish up.
Yeah, get it going.
Get good at it.
Yeah, and ignore those horrible ideas where you know, do the thing where you're looking at a porn and you're like, who's that chick? She's hot. I haven't seen her. What's her name? I'm gonna go run her name through. I'm gonna get up on Yahoo there. I'm gonna see. Maybe she's got other stuff. Now just beat off.
Yeah.
You start turning into.
I wonder where they got that furniture.
Yeah. You start.
Don't get distracted.
Well, that's the thing. Part of what people are looking for when they do the porn thing is that sort of altered state, that sort of dreamlike. You know, they're just it's like treasure hunt and this. Sort
right.
Of thing.
And
like,
what happens is I swear to Christ, I was watching a porn. 10 minutes ago. No, it was
10 minutes.
Yeah, I don't know. Could have been last year. Could have been yesterday. But I was watching porn, and I was like, "Who is this chick?" And then I thought, you know, if I fast forward to the front of the movie, I could get her name. And if I got her name, I could go up onto the computer. And then I thought, come on, Am. Please, you're an adult. Now just beat off.
You're here for a reason.
Just beat off in your gym sock and carry on with some dignity here. Don't start going on a hunt. It's that you're not Mickey Spillane,
right.
Mickey Spillane. You know what I'm saying? I'm convinced if the Davids of the world just beat themselves up, once you get on the computer, then it's game on. You're there for a long time. What about that, David? What if you just set yourself a little time limit of like 10 minutes from the time you unzipped your pants to the time you moved on to a different topic?
Yeah.
It'd be hard because I do exactly what you said. I do look for the chick and then I look for her name and I look for...
Did he drop the S word?
Maybe.
No, almost. I don't think so.
Whatever it is.
Other sites.
I talked over it, though, Anderson. Yeah. You can't hear it. Look, here's the point. Give yourself 10 minutes.
But my psychologist is saying I should get rid of it all. That's my question.
I know, but he's unrealistic.
Well, it depends if you're an addict or not. If you're an addict, you've got to go cold jerky.
If you can't beat off in 10 minutes, you're an addict. That's how you determine it.
Yeah, if you can't control... Is there any alcoholism in the family?
No. Depression and general anxiety and social anxiety. But
were you sexually abused growing up?
I guess here's the question. You just tell me if it's sexual abuse. My buddy and I are best friends, neighbors. He would come over and hang out a lot, and my brother took us out in the backyard, and he touched our penises together, and that's about it. Nothing else past that.
You're fine.
My oldest brother did sexually abuse my other brothers, but never me.
Nope.
I'm the youngest of nine.
Okay. Nine. You got to figure it's going to be some sexual abuse there.
Mm.
Okay, listen, David. Here's the deal. You're all up in your head. You're going to shrink. You're thinking too much. Yeah. You start disciplining yourself. And if you can't discipline yourself, then you're addicted.
I say you follow the direction of the guy who's tape treating.
All right.
Not Adam. You don't go.
Don't take it out on the porn. I hate to see the porn stuff.
I understand that, but sometimes, Adam.
10 minutes, you beat off. And believe me, when you're done, you're done.
There's no crime. There's no one going to judge when it comes to
porn.
Yeah,
but this guy may need the eye of the tiger in order to get him out of the house and get to a relationship.
That's possible, too, yeah. You got to have a little something in the tank. Yeah, you got to be a little bit hungry or you don't want to eat.
You're right.
Yeah. All right. And believe me, Drew's a man of passion. He knows what it's like to be hungry.
Always.
Renee?
Hello?
You're 24?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, every time I go down on a man, I get really congested in the nose and I can't breathe and it makes a hard time to finish. Mm-hmm. And I was just wondering if there's some way that can be connected to me going down on a man.
Mm-hmm.
Do you tear or anything?
What?
Do your eyes tear?
Like, my eyes tear up and my, like, nose clogs up.
All right, well, the reason...
Just say yes.
Renee, your tear ducts go directly into your nose, and when you... That's why people, when
Hold on. How does it work, by the way, when somebody says something and you then think it was your voice in your head saying
it? I know. That was Renee.
It's like, do I tear? Huh? Do what? Do you tear? I tear up and... that was our question, remember? All right, you tear up. I like that, by the way.
Yeah, well, the tearing goes right into your nose. Just, you know how when somebody cries, they get a stuffy nose?
Mm-hmm.
The reason that happens is because the tear ducts empty into the nose.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and so that's what's happening to you. Your tear, if you can prevent from tearing, your nose won't fill up with fluid.
Why are you tearing?
Yeah, why is she tearing?
Well, I don't know. I don't have a gag. I'm not gagging.
You would tear too, Adam, if you were, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you?
I think I would definitely tear.
The baby Jesus would tear if I blew a guy.
That's what I'm talking about.
Good one.
Yeah. All right. Hey, Renee.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. I don't know what is this one guy? Does he have a wide penis?
No, it's been happening for probably about the last like 6 or 7 guys I've ever done it to.
Mm. And
pay attention.
Like,
wipe your eyes.
To their pubic hair or something.
No.
Scary.
Listen, just wipe your eyes. You know, so it doesn't get down into the nose. That's all you have to do. If you keep wiping your eyes.
Do you wipe your eyes?
If you wipe the tears out of your eyes, it won't go down into your nose.
Well, how's it go down into your nose?
The tear duct's right here. Inside. Right into your nose.
Oh, and it just drains in your nose?
Just drains right into your nose.
Wiping your eyes will do it?
Well, it helps get some of the excess out. Right.
How about a fan on her face?
Yeah.
All right. All right, roll the car window down next time you're blowing the guy. Get a little air circulation in there. All right, baby doll. What can we do? Yeah, you're fine.
All right. Thank you.
All right, what about when he's on top of you? Can you breathe?
Yeah.
All right, then you're good for that. That's your thing.
All right.
Oh, wait a minute. I got a theory. Okay. I got a theory. I wonder if she's still there. Renee?
Gone.
No. I think maybe she, my theory is she maybe polished a guy off after anal. And
she was crying after the anal?
No, the scent of the.
Made her tear.
You see what I'm saying?
And she could have been crying after the anal, too, to be fair.
It's a possibility. All right. So, tip from Drew. Everyone, wipe those eyes. Crystal?
Yeah.
You're 23?
23.
What's up?
I have a question. A few months ago, I was dating this guy, and he, really great guy, but he had never gotten a blowjob where he actually finished. So, me liking to give head, I said, okay, well, you know, let me try. So,
sure.
Let me try.
So, yeah, she gets the Mission Impossible tape out.
Yeah.
Well, I'm pretty good at it, so I've been told. But I'm giving him head, and I don't know if it was because he never finished before from giving head or getting head, but I had this huge, huge load in my mouth. And normally, depending on the guy, I usually swallow it. So I didn't want to swallow it because it was...
And you mean depending on the guy? Like, you wouldn't do it with like a black guy, but a white guy? Okay, right.
I am really going to vomit.
I'm not going to be a guy for like 2 weeks. And
how did you not vomit?
Right.
Plus, how did you not
if
vomit?
If the guy's a bad tipper, for instance, you wouldn't swallow, right?
Oh, definitely not.
How did you not vomit? How did
So I kind of gesture to him like I need to spit it out.
What? You want to go out and eat? You want to go out for Thai food? What's that?
Where's the destiny over here?
I guess we'll go to my folks' place for Thanksgiving. I can't understand you with all that goo in your mouth.
No, just hold on a second.
All right. that's what it would sound like, bro.
You would just go, I'm a zip.
Hey, Crystal?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you tried to talk to the guy.
Okay, so he gives me a Pepsi can. I said no. He gestures to the window, and there's no way I was
Pepsi
sitting.
Can.
He gestures.
Hold on. Right. This sounds like Sir Walter Raleigh here.
Product placement.
This is what a member of the royal family. Then gestures.
Pepsi can. No.
And gestures toward the window.
Oh my God.
Again.
He pointed towards the ashtray. I said no.
They held the Pepsi. And by the way, hold on.
Yeah.
Whenever you got to use the can to put back in, whether it's tobacco spittle, you know, or it's a little vomit or a little spunk, it's always bad times. And believe me, that can always gets set down somewhere.
Oh, my God. It. Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. I've been at many a party.
Without the Pepsi can. Pepsi can.
All right. Listen, Dicky, blow it out the window. Wait a minute. Use the sunroof.
The Pepsi can wouldn't have worked. Don't even
All right,
bother.
Crystal, so then he gestured to the window, and then what?
Okay, so I go to the bathroom, and I spit it out after I turn the light on, and I just happen to look in the sink, and this was bright yellow, like almost like a shade less than, like,
Mountain Dew.
That's much nicer. Chartreuse. Mm-hmm. That's very nice.
So
bright yellow.
Yeah, and I called my friend on the phone because I was really scared.
From the bathroom?
There's no way I was going to swallow that, and I got pretty, like, freaked out because I know what cum pretty much looks like, and I've never seen that color before. And so I never gave him head again. Well, we're not dating anymore, and now I'm dating this guy, and he wants me to go down on him. And
Is it, like, egg yellow?
Yeah.
What?
Like,
was egg.
Like
and she has post-traumatic cum disorder now.
Wow.
So
PTSD.
Yeah.
So now I'm kind of hesitant to go down on another guy because I don't know if this guy had something. One and two, like that, just completely ruined giving a head to me.
All right. Well, listen here. First off, what about the dozens of guys you successfully blew before you ran into the guy with the yellow fever? Do you know what I'm saying?
Well, no.
Maybe they had it too, but now that I know.
Oh, she never looked at it before.
Oh, you just pictured everything as a yellow that was going into you.
Okay, here's the deal. Yeah. The yellow is just him, and it basically means it's sort of old.
Yeah.
Been in there for a while. Been cooking.
Yeah, he's a coward.
And same with the size, too. That's sort of a duration since last emission kind of thing.
Right.
For the most part.
Wow.
The volume.
I've never had yellow.
But this is a message. This is sort of a wake up to you that the semen is infectious. You could put a condom on the guys, they'll be fine. You can do that.
All right, but let's not take it out on the new guy.
Yeah, I don't want to punish him. And I really like him, and we've been dating for a while, but what am I supposed to say? What color is your cum before I give you head? You know?
Yeah. I could commit to white and we could move forward.
Maybe fire one off and check that.
Yeah. That's
and then the next one's going to be fresh, so that won't be yellow.
Tell you what you do. You do like, you know, in the ballistics lab down at the police department, FBI, they get the gun, you know, they fire it into a barrel of water and they retrieve the slug. He's got to fire a shot off into the sink.
Or the can, the Pepsi can.
Here's the test. You lay out a sheet of white paper. He drops a load on it. If you can't find it, he's good. You see what I'm
He's
saying?
An angel, too.
If it looks like someone busted an egg on it, then there's trouble. That's what I'm saying.
The next one will be okay, because that's just the old one.
Oh, that's the old one.
Yeah, the new bullet's going to be white.
Well, I say you got to check again, but Crystal.
Yeah.
What you need to do is you need to, you need to get back on that horse.
Yes.
Right.
Okay? You need to start blowing the horse.
That condom needs to, that horse needs to wear a condom.
The horse should have a condom. And look, don't get into it with the new guy about the other guy you're blowing with the big yellow load. And
I haven't. I haven't.
Okay,
I haven't said anything.
He doesn't want to hear that.
Yellow load and the Pepsi.
And it's like, why didn't you blow it in a can? It was too much. The can was only 12 ounces. We had a 2-liter bottle that we probably could have used, but he was using it for a bong. It was tough.
He offered me a shoe. Pepsi can. Then I decided on the bathroom.
I gave the guy anal. This is how he treats me. The nerve. I like the difference in guys' attitude pre-blown load and post-blown load. Like pre-blown is like, hey baby, what do you need? What do we got to do? Anything? Post is use the window, use the mailbox, use my dad's slipper. Just get the hell out of it. Please take it outside.
I like the new syndrome we've coined too, the PTCD.
Yeah. I like it, by the way, when you're disgusted after the load that it's still in someone's mouth. Oh, please, get rid of it. What is that doing there? Have some dignity.
How dare you?
Let's see, I'm trying to watch TV. Mark?
Hi.
You're 18?
Sure. I really enjoyed your work on Red Handed. I just wanted to tell you.
Oh, yeah. Forgot about that.
I found old tape the other weekend. It was really good.
Television triumph.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to say, I hope you can bring Bill Simmons on one day. Great guest, I think.
Yeah.
Bill Simmons is awesome.
Bill Simmons is, yeah. Hold on. Just shut up for a second, Mark, would you?
Sure, sorry.
Bill Simmons is a dear, dear friend who's a writer for Jimmy Kimmel Live, who has a very popular, he writes for ESPN as a column online that everyone's into. I, however, don't like computers or reading, so I don't know of his work. But everyone tells me how fantastic he is.
It's really good.
Now that Dicky's part of the...
But I was a fan of Bill Simmons before.
Oh, you were? Yeah. Well, now that Dicky's part of the Jimmy Kimmel family, he's a dear, dear friend of Dicky's as well.
He was a Boston sports guy.
Oh, really?
Right.
Yeah. He writes about the Red Sox and the heartache. And
yeah. You know what, you know what I love?
I went to college with Dan Duquette.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, never heard of him. You know what I love about the Boston faithful who are Red Sox fans? Already planning next season. Already talking about it. You never get a break.
So are they, so why shouldn't we?
They're playing in 2010. What are you talking about?
Just never
get a break. And talking about 1923.
Yeah, and let me just say this, Dickie, and I just hope you don't fall into this thing. But now I'm working with a lot of a-holes from Boston at the Jimmy show. And here's the thing. Could you imagine let's just swap it. Let's just pretend I moved to Boston. I hooked up with a bunch of guys from Boston. They were writers. We were working on a show. And I never shut up about the Rams and the Dodgers. I just never stopped talking about the Dodgers. Everyone, if the Dodgers
Let's make it realistic. You were from San Francisco and talked about the Giants.
Yeah.
It's impossible. The Dodgers, they take
I would accept it more for a longer time.
If the Giants lost, people would have to apologize to me and like, hey, buddy, hey, sorry about what went on. I never stopped holding court about it. I never stopped, and no one ever told me to. How long do you think it would take someone to tell me to shut the F up?
Let me just say that. You don't understand.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You just don't understand. You don't know what it's like. You don't know.
Here's all I'm saying about living in L.A. What other town are you forced to deal with an ass full of everyone else's sports?
Right.
You know what I mean? I got to sit there, and I got to listen to guys living and dying with Pittsburgh teams, guys living and dying with Buffalo teams, especially Sox fans, a lot of Chicago guys. I got to sit in a room with a bunch of guys that are like in different forms of depression or elation, depending on how they... And I have thousands of hours over the last 2 years locked into Boston Red Sox baseball conversation.
Here's a good example of what Boston is like. Lenny Clark was on the show last week, and Wayne Gretzky was about to come out, and Jimmy asked Lenny, you know, Lenny's from Boston, you know, who's the greatest hockey player that ever
lived? Bobby Orr.
No, Bobby Orr.
Bobby Orr.
I mean, you're about to meet Gretzky.
Yeah.
I'm standing over there in my head, all that's flashing is Bobby Orr, Bobby Orr. And he probably isn't. But if you're from Boston, he is.
Right.
And he's going to shake Gretzky's hand in about 30 seconds, and he still says Bobby Orr.
And
just the way we are.
And now the computer's destroyed everything because it's all nothing but emails and fantasy teams, and it's just Boston this, Chicago this,
Buffalo
that.
Yeah, I'm not one of those guys, though. I'm passionate about the Sox, and I love Boston sports.
You want them to win, but you don't. You don't take that and dump it on everyone else's lap who isn't interested in it. That's okay. All right. I'm just saying, how long would I last in Boston just talking about the Giants? Nonstop Giant talk. Wearing Giants jerseys there. Having people come up and apologize to me if they lost or congratulate me if they won. I mean, they would just kick the ass out of me and toss me out the fifth story, right?
If you did that, you wouldn't last long, but if you didn't do that, like all of my friends, you're an honorary Boston guy. The fact that I know you, you're like a hero there.
He can't hear you.
They can't imagine.
He can't even hear the question.
I'm just saying, L.A.
No, I do hear the question.
L.A. has no identity, so you see, here's what L.A. is. It's a blank etch-a-sketch. Right. So we can just come in and start doing our own thing. Like, everyone just sets up shop here and it says, hey, we're going to start.
Boston does it, and I know it, but you don't understand.
L.A.
You have to.
L.A. is filled with sports bars. That
call your old college buddy. He made me answer.
If you're an Eagles fan, you go to this bar.
Right.
If you're a Bears fan, you go to that bar. If you're a Pats fan, you go to that bar. What other city would have 150 bars for other teams?
Yeah, that's Los Angeles.
Yeah. God, I hate this place.
There we go.
All right. And then you got a choice between that. You got a choice between talking Boston or talking Buffalo football or people that don't speak English. That's your choice. You talk to people that don't speak a lick of English, or you talk to guys fanatical.
Everybody talks about
the Bills.
Well, I guess you know. That's no surprise. Movies. You know, I'm not going to see movies out here.
Well, I only see movies about the Red Sox.
I'm not going to go to movies. If you see me at a party, don't try to ask me about movies.
We're going to take ourselves a little break. Dicky Barrett here from the Mighty Bosstones. And, of course, Jimmy Kimmel Live. And we'll be right back after
Sox
this.
Sox fan. Wow.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191. Oh, wow, you can know you can go, wow, you can know you can.
We'll be right back. LoveLine is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom. The most trusted for over 80 years.
Why are we listening? Who is this?
I like 50, that.
50 Cent.
Oh, really?
Oh, is that him?
All right. Does anyone like this song?
Mm-hmm.
I try and work it in like very rarely.
Yeah, good. I work it in less rarely.
Less than rarely.
It's just sort of annoying, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't like it.
Listen, I know, well, you know, you got Pop Squirrel and Old Man Drew over here, but that sounds annoying. Yeah. Now that's rock and roll there. Yeah,
that's theme a song.
Yeah, it's my theme. Yeah, I don't even know who this is, but I know we've had him, Jimmy Eat World. I know we've had him on the show.
Chris knows.
Dicky Barrett is here tonight from the Mighty Bosstones. He's a dear friend, and you can also find him on Jimmy Kimmel Live, doing the announcing and doing a fine job, I might add. A Santa Claus is the name of the CD he's on, as well as Blink 182 and Newfound Glory and Something Corporate and a bunch of other good bands, and that is out, and the money goes to Pediatric AIDS. So there ye have it.
Well done. Thank you.
All right. Let's talk to Dan, who's 18.
Hello.
Dan?
I'm the only one in my family who has not drinking or smoked, and it just seems like every once in a while my friends or my family would want to, you know, drink and would want to have me drink with them when I do not want to, and it just goes over this over and over again, you know, on the holidays and every time I go out.
All right, here's the deal. So is there alcoholism in your family?
Yes, there is. My father committed suicide. So,
all right, so there's a couple of things. Yeah. One is you have about a 50% risk of inheriting that gene.
That's why now, I don't smoke today.
Interestingly, though, the fact that you were so uninterested kind of suggests you don't have the gene, but you can never be sure. That's number one. Number two, it's against the law for you to drink.
Yes.
And so there you go. That's
but
all you got to say.
Stop people. Right.
Your parents don't. They.
Wait. You go at family functions.
They force
your mom has like got a beer bong out. She's yelling chug.
My mom has been sober for 2 years now.
Your dad drank himself to death. Your mom's been sober for 2 years. Where's all the family pressure come for you to drink during functions?
My uncles and aunts and my cousins. They got their cousins to drink when they were 13, and they've been trying to do it on me ever since.
All right, hold on one second.
Interestingly, there's a bunch of literature that suggests first drink by 15 increases your risk of alcoholism by about sixfold.
Ooh.
And what's strangely...
Oh, I did it at 13.
There you go.
Cool.
Yeah, no.
Well, less than 15.
By
it's got to be right at 15.
And interestingly, rodents in the lab.
I tried
adolescent
a rodent
rodents,
when I was 13.
Adolescent rodents, same thing. Exactly. It's bizarre.
Really?
We don't know what that
Where
is all about.
Where do rodents even get booze?
The lab rodents.
Oh.
We pour it. That's the beer bong.
Oh.
The lab guy's got a beer bong.
At 13, I had trouble getting booze, and rodents are coming up.
All right. Oh, hold on a second. Also, Dan's got some energy. And
alcohol
some
family.
Weird...
I
know, but...
Dad died of alcohol.
I know, but he has a distorted perception, I believe, of reality to some degree. Like, everyone's trying to get me to drink.
Maybe.
My cousin's trying to get
me. Yeah, maybe.
If it's like, your brother died or my dad died, who was your brother, whoever, of alcoholism, my mom's sober,
yeah.
you're pressuring him to drink?
Nah.
I mean, really?
Nah.
No. But
it's around, so.
Dan.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. You don't have to hang out with those people if that's the way you feel.
Yeah, but it's to the point where I don't have very many friends in the first place, but the ones that I do try to get me to drink, and it's just like, No, I don't really.
They've not been respectful of how traumatizing alcohol has been.
Tell me your dad died.
And my dad died when I was 11, and he died of cocaine and morphine.
Fantastic.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's different.
And and by the way, I've listened to you guys ever since I went to my boarding school. So, you guys have pretty much been my male role model.
Real
Adam is your
thank
real
you.
Model.
And,
combine us. Don't let it be either one of us.
And my,
thank
my
you.
Boarding school. Everyone listens to you, by the way, at the boarding school.
I mean, well, thank
what
them.
School?
What's the name of it?
Handle Boy Center.
Handle Boy?
Hannah.
For Christ's sake, I thought it was Handle.
No, it's the cartoon Boy Center.
Hannah Boy Center. Yeah.
And that's what they talk about all the time. You know, oh, did you hear Love One the other night? Oh, did you hear Love One? Oh, yeah.
All right, well, go fighting pedophiles. What's the name of the team?
They don't have a football team. I go to college now, so, you know.
Oh, okay. All right. Listen, that's bad news. You go to a boys' school. Hannah's the name of the school, and there's no football team. You got to figure you're getting felt up at that school pretty good. You know what I mean?
I don't know about that.
No. You know, it's funny. Whenever I hear about these hazings, they do these news stories. Yeah. They're like, they're at the football camp, and then they're like, they interview the parents, and they're like, first off, I always love it when the announcers, John Stossel's interviewing the distraught family, or it's Barbara Walters or whoever, it's Connie Chung, and they've never heard of anything. It's always funny. Like the mom's like, well, they did something called teabagging. John Stossel's gotta be, what is this teabagging? It's important. It's important for you not to know what a rim job is or teabagging is or anything. Like if you're John Stossel and they go, what they did to him was called, I know teabagging. Don't worry. I practically invented it. Yeah, I mean, you got to act confused. And sometimes it's crazy. Like Barbara Walters never heard of nipples and stuff. She'd be like, fondled your breasts. I don't, what is that? Fondle. What is that? They play stupid for journalists. Let's put it this way. You're a journalist, right?
I'm not sure they're playing stupid sometimes.
Okay, but let's put it this way. You're a journalist.
Yeah.
You're doing a story with a family whose kid was physically or sexually abused.
Yeah.
Part of it was the teabagging.
Yeah.
Don't you get the bio, the paper, read the stuff? Haven't you heard teabagging? If you don't know what teabagging is, 2 weeks before this, when the assignment comes to you, don't you say to someone at the office, hey, Lou, don't show me, but what is teabagging? I got this, says it in the article. You get on the internet and look it up. You know, the mom says you have to act surprised.
Look,
what is this teabagging?
Here's what comes up on the prompter tomorrow morning.
Right.
Drew's
showing me. Drew's doing what are you doing?
Today's show.
They
and that's it. That's their prep.
They see the stuff. But I say they say they don't know what it is. It makes them sound less lascivious. You know what I mean?
Right.
If you know what all this dirty stuff is,
well,
it makes you
not just
makes
lascivious.
You creep.
It means you've been there.
You've been there. Right. Stossel's done some bagging is what that means. Give me a break. Give me a bag. So it's like, but they always talk to the parents and the kid, poor kid sitting in between. It's always the same kid. There's a kind of bad skin, blockhead, and a bad teenage haircut.
Bad
and the
haircut,
bangs
right,
down and the choker. It makes their head look even fatter in the one earring, you know. They look like.
The ears stick out.
Right. And they're just sitting there and they're like, So the kids held you down while one of them put his scrotum in your mouth. Oh, dear Lord, that is shocking. And I'm always laughing. I'm thinking, oh, God, I wish I thought of that.
Oh, my God.
All we were doing is pissing on everybody. We forgot about the teabag. I wish I would have got to the teabag. Yeah, but they're always disgusted. And they don't have a context for it. It becomes a sexual assault. But it's not really a sexual assault. It's just abuse.
It's abuse, yeah.
See, that's the whole thing that I don't think they understand, the newscasters and the parents and stuff. It's like, your kid was not sexually assaulted. He was assaulted with a scrotum sack, wasn't sexual.
Right.
It was to humiliate.
Right.
That's the whole thing. Yeah.
And yet, Dr. Freud might have a few different...
it's good. That's just good sound abuse there.
Yeah.
And listen, hey, you want to make the team? You want to make the team.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
What is this teabagging?
Yes.
I always like that. Tell me about the teabag. What is the process? Now, the bag is steeped in one's mouth, yes?
They attempted to fist my fist.
Fist. What is fist?
Is that like belt?
rectally rape my... What rap? Rectal. What is this? Anus. The anus. What is anus? Bunghole. No, don't know bunghole. He took a mop handle and forced it. Mop handle. What is a mop?
They ball bagged my... They did
ball
what?
Bag. Now, yeah. They hold on.
And even while I use my imagination, I can't imagine what that... Bowling ball bag.
They want him to explain it, too. That's the thing. Yeah. They would like them to...
In front of the boy.
How does that go? Junior, lie down. Let daddy demonstrate using a throw pillow.
It's an actual tea bag.
Michael?
Yes?
You're 21?
Yes, I am.
What's up?
I'm having like a problem. Well, it's been for a real while. That my left testicle feels like, you know...
Testicle? Like, what is that?
Testicle. You got to be a little more specific.
Is that part of the bag?
Yeah, I don't... these terms.
Well, I guess I'm a little innocent because I don't know what teabag is.
All right. What's wrong with your testicle?
You and John Stossel. Well,
it's like really tight. Like the veins in the behind it, it's like really connecting. It's like really pulling on it, you know?
It feels like it's pulling.
Yeah, it feels like it's pulling. It's like really
tight. Don't assume it actually is pulling. It just feels like there's a pulling sensation.
It feels like, nobody's pulling on it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And,
does it get up into your abdomen?
Yeah, exactly. It's in my abdomen, and it's like on the left inner thigh.
And then radiate down your leg, too?
Yeah.
Mm-mm. All right, you got to get that checked out. Why haven't you gotten that checked out?
I did. I got like some medicine for it, and
medicine.
It just numbed the pain.
Over the counter?
No, wait a minute, Michael.
You put some Anusol on it.
It's probably something called epididymitis.
Okay.
Is that what they told you it was?
Yeah. No, they actually didn't tell me.
All right, but it could be a torsion where the testicle twists on itself and cuts off its own blood supply and can be quite serious.
Oh, really?
So you need to see a urologist. They probably need to do an ultrasound. They'll put you on some anti-inflammatories initially and figure out what this is. But to get see a urologist, all right?
Yeah. Or you'll be teabagging with half a bag, yes, Drew?
Yeah.
Or a swollen bag.
Oh.
Big bag. Big teabag.
You got to shoehorn that bag into the mug.
Yeah,
that's tough.
Shoehorn.
What is a shoehorn? Now, I've heard of shoe. That's when you want a fly to go away.
If you give me a second, let me just put my own mind to it. Nope. I still can't imagine.
We're going to talk to Peter as a question for Dicky. We got to take a break, but no, let's get to Peter. Peter?
Fun.
Peter?
Yeah?
Young Peter, you're 14. What's your question for Dicky?
Uh-oh.
I want to know what the purpose of the dancing guy in your band is.
That's an interesting question. Dancing guy. These terms you use. Ben was been with us for many years since the band started.
Right.
And, originally, our very first show we ever played, we went from Joe's Garage to the Rat Nightclub, and they said that everybody had to be over 21 or performing in the band. You couldn't be a roadie. We had him figure.
Oh, really?
He'll be the roadie. You know, when you start the band, you're like, you're going to be the roadie. And,
right. And this is
school of rock.
And Ben's just a buddy.
Ben's a buddy, and we couldn't imagine him not being there because he was at all the practices and drank the beer with us. And
right, and you're in Joe Gittleman's garage?
Yeah.
All right, and now you're going to play
Joe Gittleman's mom's garage.
Garage. Yeah. And now you're going to play...
That's such a great memory, dude.
Now you're going to play the Rat Club.
Yeah.
And you can't get Ben in.
And they're saying, so now the whole group's not going to be there, like
now,
all
how old's
of us.
Ben at the time?
Ben was probably 19.
All right, so he's got to be part of the band, but he doesn't play anything.
Right.
Right.
So I said, Ben, you know, when the music starts, get up there. I don't care what you do. And, you know,
the rest is history.
That's what he came up with.
The rest is history.
And he's never
looked back.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I've seen the Bosstones many times and said this many times. It is great to see Ben dancing on stage.
Yeah.
He's going back and forth. He's got his ska thing on. He's always wearing a nice suit. And it's just something great and novel about it. And the good part is he's not that good a dancer, but he's not bad. He's just not good enough to be distracting, you know?
But he looks like a buddy. He looks like a pal, yeah.
Yeah,
I want to hang out with that guy.
Yeah, he has a couple of good moves. He's going back and forth on stage, and it's it really adds to it.
You know what? He's the sweetest guy on earth. I've never heard him say an unkind word about anybody.
No, unkind. Yeah. Word?
No.
What does that mean, Drew?
It's a stretch for you.
And he's heard me say...
Well, we go pee.
Unkind things about him?
You're going to go what?
pee? What is that?
What is this?
Is that like pee bag?
Yeah.
What is it? We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
LoveLine.
LoveLine.
We'll be right back.
LoveLine. LoveLine. With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. Live 105. Alternative. San Francisco.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Dicky Barrett in here tonight. Dear, dear friend, Dicky Barrett from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones. You can also find Dicky, by the way, not only singing with the Bosstones, but also on this new album. It's called A Santa Claus, and it's a punk rock Christmas CD, and it's got a lot of cool bands on it. Bosstones, the aforementioned Bosstones, Blink 182, Newfound Glory, Something Corporate, and a bunch of other bands. And all the money goes to Pediatric AIDS. So there's your cause.
So you drove Dickie here tonight.
I picked up Dickie.
So we can't talk tonight.
Drew and I usually... Well, I'll tell you what. Usually, Drew and I speak via the cell phone on the ride home. But, you know...
You're going to drop him off.
I'll drop Dickie off.
Yeah.
And then the party will start when I get to talk to Drew on the cell phone.
I promise, you know, when I nail down this job and if I plan on living out.
You've got a car.
I'll get a vehicle, yeah.
Yeah?
Not a big car.
You didn't say car.
Adam has a ton of cars.
A Segway.
Yeah. No, I like vehicles, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I want to talk to this guy. Right. I want our Victoria. It's a chick.
Yeah.
All right. Victoria?
Hi.
You're 19. What's up?
I've got, like...
Wow.
This is why I did not go to her, Adam.
Unbelievable.
Okay?
Oh, shut up.
No, no, I wasn't going to go to her at all tonight.
I was feeling that,
too. Has death fetish, gets off looking at pictures of dead women. That seems like a good call. See, now you want to talk to menstrual cramps.
It just... Well, let's go back to her.
Extremely painful.
Now we got to finish this back.
Look, here's Drew. Listen, kids, here's what you get with Drew. Carolyn. She's 16. She's calling from San Francisco. Menstrual cramps are extremely painful, period. Worse than normal, period. Yeah. Remedy.
That was going to be a quick one, and then we're going to go to this one.
That was going
to
be a quick one, my ass.
Yeah, it's a quick one.
Let's see. Boyfriend was bisexual, claims it was a phase, and he's over it. All right, that's better. I don't want to talk about menstrual cramps.
Well, let's finish with Victoria. I'm sorry.
All right, well, hold on. Let me yell at Victoria for a second. Victoria.
Yeah?
Listen, screwball, you cannot use the F word or the S word. Do you understand me?
On the radio.
I can't.
Real life, you can.
All right, wait a minute. Hey, listen, Victoria, we're going to hang up on you in just 1 second if you don't start playing ball, okay?
What do you want to hear?
And now the phone the thing goes dead. Are you there, Victoria?
Yeah, what do you want to hear?
I just don't want to hear any more profanity, all right?
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, so...
Unacceptable.
You have a death fetish.
Yeah.
You like to look at pictures of dead people?
Yeah, and I don't understand why someone would be interested in something like that.
Are you fascinated with it, or is it a sexual thing?
It's very sexual.
It's sexual for you.
Mm-hmm. You masturbate to dead people's pictures?
Can I just clear something up real quick?
Yes.
I don't mean, like... mangled, mutilated kind of bodies. I mean, just when someone looks like they're sleeping and at peace and like they have no say in the matter, but they don't look, you know, terrible or anything.
You're fat. Yeah, I've heard of this. I've heard of this before, too, where people need them. In order to feel sexual, they have to be with somebody who's actually not there, who's dead.
We could hook up.
Yeah, Adam, we'd be perfect partner for you.
I play possum while you blow me. Hold on. I don't understand why the possum would need to watch SportsCenter. Don't argue with my possum. Just start blowing. I do death my way. You do it your way. I like to eat and watch ESPN.
Yeah, don't worry. His eyes won't move.
Yeah. I won't blink.
Is it all right if I just get serious with Dr. Drew for a second? Because I've really been wanting to know.
Yeah, it is. Instead of it suggests that you've been highly, highly traumatized, and that you're sort of connecting with a part of yourself that's very highly disconnected and dissociated.
I don't remember anything bad ever happening to me, but my memories before the age of 12 are very shady. So maybe something horrible happened tonight.
All right, so and explicit memory before the age of 12, having none, is very unusual. And not only could there be things that you could perhaps get your hands on or begin to recall explicitly, God knows this is evidence that there is implicit memory left behind, that the brain function has been altered by the things that were happening.
All right, so what should she do?
Well, if she's, it's therapy. If she was interested, if she can find somebody that can cooperate with this and she can have a close relationship in spite of it, that's one thing.
True.
But if she's having lots of symptoms, mm-hmm. that's time to get checked out.
True. I just had this wacky thought.
Yeah.
You got a couple minutes, and I'm tired of talking to people. Now, listen. You have all these memories, and once in a while, things pop in your head, and they hit hard. I mean, you're 9 years old, and they become clear. Like, you go, oh, yeah, I could see the kind of kid I was, or I could see myself thinking about this already, or I could see the way my parents were when I was this age or that age. And it's important. I mean,
your brain syncing up, reintegrating.
Right.
If that's because you're in therapy, that stuff happens to you.
How dare you? Here's the point. I just teabagged.
The therapist?
Here's what I'm saying. Do you think we will come to a time, and are we working on this time, where is all this stuff in our consciousness somewhere, in our brain?
Some of it is and some of it isn't.
Some is, some isn't. More than we can access at this point.
No, more of it is left implicitly in terms of how the brain functions, and that's what we're beginning to come to terms with, is how to interpret the implicit remnants of experience.
But what I'm saying is if you really start focusing on a period of your life, an age of your life, the friends you had, the activities you did, the guys that were on your baseball team or your football team or your schoolmates or something, you can start bringing up vivid images.
Yes, lots of things you might not know.
Is there going to be a time, do you think, that we'll be able to sort of manufacture or tap into that, unleash it, go back? Do you know what I'm saying? And other than with, let's just say, being hypnotized. I'm talking about a couple electrodes planted on your head, you closing your eyes, getting a sleep deprivation tank before you know it, you're playing a Little League game that you played 28 years ago. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Would you have to play the same way?
He wants total recall.
I'm not going to strike out. That's my point.
No, there is no total recall machine or anything like that.
Yeah.
Nothing like that.
We're
working on
it.
Nothing like that.
Is that game in my head somewhere?
There's no way of knowing.
Pieces of it. Yeah,
but depends what age you're. If you're 9, 10, yes, pieces of it are probably there.
What about a high school football game?
Oh, yes.
It's all in there.
You should have that.
Yeah. It's in there.
Yeah.
Well, let's go get it.
Well.
Use this pen.
If you actually talk to therapy.
All right.
So it might resurface.
All right. Let's take ourselves a little break. Dicky here from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones and Jimmy Kimmel Live. And we'll be right back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
Loveline. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Is it with a G or a J?
G. Thank Christ.
Hey, everybody. Well, that's the show. Hey, tomorrow night, Nicole Richie, daughter of Lionel Richie, is going to be... And isn't it going to be sad when our listeners don't know who Lionel Richie is?
Yeah.
That's impossible.
It will happen.
It will happen.
Remember, he was singing the Olympics before most of our listeners were born.
All right.
Yeah, the Commodores, though, and the...
I want to thank...
long before. Right.
Maybe I should come down and
I want to thank a dear, dear, dear friend, Dickie Barrett,
thank you
for coming in tonight. Santa Claus is the name of the CD. The Bosstones and many other cool bands are on. And also, you can go to www.bosstones.com if you want to find out anything about the band. See Dickie doing the announcing on Jimmy Kimmel Live. And until next time, this is Adam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying... Mahalo. I can't understand you with all that goo in your mouth.
Hold on a second. Why?
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Ingold. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.